text-to-speech tools for the autodidact, and a lot more this time on Hack 5.
Hello, welcome to Hack 5. I'm Darren Kitchen.
I'm Shannon Morse.
It's your weekly dose of Technolust.
Welcome to this super exciting episode of Hack 5.
Thank you for joining us.
I almost said tech thing.
We remember what show we're on, and that's, I mean, we put pants on this morning.
We put pants on.
Hey.
I have pants on.
Right?
Yeah, totally.
Unlike some podcasters, because I don't know if you've ever, you know, seen some video podcasts where you can't tell.
Yeah,
I have. Which is one of the unique benefits of being a podcaster.
It's got awkward real quick.
I know, right? Well, we're actually doing a podcast, as it were, this episode.
We are. We're talking about cool things.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess we talk about cool things in every single episode.
We do.
At least I think it's cool. So we're podcasters in every episode, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
This is one of those.
Yes, it is one of those.
And it starts with a gift from a fan?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, it does. So we're going to go ahead and start this out early this episode. First off, we got a sticker.
Oh.
Yeah, isn't that cute? Please. Wheelchair Hacker. So this is from Z Kyle T, or Z Kylet. He says, Darren and Shannon, I'm a huge Hack 5 fan. I keep saving up for the Nano Tactical Elite, the Rubber Ducky, and Lamb Turtle. Due to my disability, it's hard for me to hold books, so I'm really looking forward to when you release an ebook version of the Wi-Fi Pineappling book in the Hack 5 Field Kit Pocket Guide. I am too. I'm looking forward to that. Please enjoy this Wheelchair Hacker sticker I made from an image I found online. I also wanted to tell you about a device I'm making.
Oh.
It's a Nano Pi that gets power and a network connection using a power over Ethernet adapter. It then uses a USB Wi-Fi adapter to broadcast a fake Wi-Fi network.
Hey, that's really cool.
Huh. Yeah.
I love those kind of hacks.
All of this is on the back of a blank wall plate, which can easily be substituted for an Ethernet drop. What do you think, and what should I call it?
I don't know. Cucumber. Well, I have no idea, but there's something beautiful about the clandestine, like, tailored access operations type stuff.
There
that
is.
The hacker community builds. I would know, because I like building them too.
Right?
Yes. So I don't know what
to
call
it. We built our company on building products for other pen testers.
It's really weird how that works out.
I don't know. It's crazy.
Well, it's actually building boxes like
building
I did
boxes.
As a kid. Red, blue, green, and it's reason why all of the Hack 5 products are in those little envelopes of
That's
colored,
true.
Of different colored. So we've got the green, the red, the blue. Oh, nobody knows about the red yet. But anyway, colored boxes.
We also got a bunch. I don't want to run through these super, super quick because, you know, it'll take a little bit of time to stick all of these on there. So in the next episode, you'll see all of these stuck onto our back walls of our set. But we got quite a few different stickers from ShmooCon that we just recently went to. We got Fortigo Labs, a bunch from the Wi-Fi Village, including Wi-Fi Security, 1997 to 2016. That's so said. SDR is a sideshow. I don't remember what this one says, because it's written in like rune or something.
It says Doomgoon.
Doomgoon? Is that what it says?
I think. I might be wrong.
I don't know. I can't read it.
All right.
DJ Rance.
Lots of stickers.
Yeah, lots and lots of stickers. So we'll stick those up. But today, why don't we go ahead and get started?
Yeah, yeah. I love the sticker part of the hacker culture, but there's
too.
So much more to discuss.
There's a lot more to hacker culture.
Some OG hackers.
Some OG hackers, like Leonardo da Vinci, Charles Darwin, did you know, Thomas Edison, Jimi Hendrix, David Bowie, Steven Spielberg, and Shannon Morse. What do those all have in common? What would you think?
I'm the Watson right now, so I'm gonna say, I don't know, Shannon, tell me.
Each person is an autodidact. That is to say, they are a self-taught person, which I have been self-teaching myself for a very long time. So Darren actually taught me that word today. So Darren, why are you teaching me new words?
Because I was, what it is I was thinking about that impromptu conversation that we had at ShmooCon.
Yeah, which, you know, I was very surprised that so many people really enjoyed that.
This is kind of inspiring the episode. We're going to have much more nitty-gritty technical content here real soon, but that conversation, which you just kind of slipped in the episode, I didn't realize she was recording, was kind of the inspiration here and had me thinking, which reminds me that you're a fantastic editor, and I'm so grateful, for real. Like,
you're welcome.
Yes, indeed. We're ridiculously lucky here. But it got me thinking about the journey of the hacker and how, for the most part, it really stems from essentially an eagerness to learn. I mean, hacking isn't taught in schools, and for the most part, it is a solo learning experience. Mm-hmm. I know that when I got started, knowledge was disseminated by the way of like text files that were shared on bulletin board systems and
IRC.
Yeah, random yeah. FTP servers. You know, and now as the underground hacking community has kind of morphed into an information security industry, it has gotten way more accessible, but it's still very much like a personal journey, you know?
That's really true. Similar to a lot of you guys probably out there, my journey started with Googling lots and lots of different things, and then I found Hack 5. And this whole world of information was at my fingertips, but was when I was in school, you know, when I was going through college and high school, which was kind of a long time ago, there wasn't a class at my school about InfoSec or one about, you know, making like with Arduinos and stuff, because that didn't exist. There wasn't something for hacking. So if I wanted to learn, I had to self-teach myself. And it's been kind of a tough journey. Just personally, just because of who I am, who I was born as well as educationally, if that's a word. I have tried very hard to fill that void in the hacker community that has existed for a very long time. You know, you find out about all these incredible hacks that people are doing, but nobody ever tells you, this is how you start. You know, this is how you begin the hack. They just give you the end slate. They're just like, here's my ending thing. Check it out on this YouTube video, and it's awesome. But they don't tell you, like, how they got there. And you can learn theory all day, and we teach a lot of theory on this show, especially with Hack Tips. And you can learn commands all day, which I've taught on Hack Tips as well. But there's always a missing step. So I've always tried to fill in that information and share it in a way that like anybody can be introduced to it. Because I feel like if you can't you can't really self-teach yourself if you don't know where to start.
Right.
And a lot of problems, I find that finding the starting point is the hardest part.
Yeah, and knowing that starting part, really, for me, it all comes down to being inspired.
Yeah.
And
yes,
that's,
it does.
That's really a lot of what we try to do on Hack 5 is to inspire. I mean, we can't hold everybody's hand and walk them through every single thing because I can't make you a hacker any more than you can make me one, but I can inspire you so that when you go and do it yourself, that it's not foreign and it just makes it more accessible. So I know we've been doing this for 11 years now. And you know,
I feel so old.
You know what? Let's come back to the age thing in the D block.
Okay.
But but anyway, what I wanted to do was just continue to share something that will help inspire you for your own personal journey. And one of the places where I always get inspired is Wikipedia. I love Wikipedia. I profess my undying love to Wikipedia.
For real?
Oh my gosh. It's the sum of all human knowledge.
You're a Wikipedia nerd. That's so cute.
Not quite a Wikipedia.
You remember the days when libraries would be like, Wikipedia does not count as a source?
Well, it doesn't, but it counts as a great starting off space to get inspired by things. And I will, like many of you, go down the Wikipedia rat hole. And I love that. I love knowledge. Crazy thirst for knowledge like all of you. It's why you ended up at this channel.
Yeah.
So I thought I would spend some time showing off what one of my favorite Wikipedia apps. This is not a roundup. This is not a top 10. This is the top number one because this is the app that changed my life.
Really?
Yes.
Okay,
and,
so what's it called?
So it's called Readable for Wikipedia.
Okay.
It's by ArcDatum. You can find it in the Google Play Store. Yeah. It's for Android. And it is
it free?
It is. It's a rewritten version of an app known as WikiLecturer, which unfortunately was removed from the App Store like a little over a year ago, and it broke my heart.
Aww.
Yeah. But during, like, for example, Hack Across America, the 2013 trip that I did with the van, that was 7,000 miles. That was over 150 hours of just driving. So for the most part, I was listening to Wikipedia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, that's awesome.
So let me show you the app and then, you know, kind of how it works.
Okay.
This is the app right now, just pulled up to one of the pages in my playlist right now. And I'm just doing a little learning here on the Dutch East India Company, as you do. And what's really cool is you see the play controls at the bottom.
Dutch East India Company. This article is about the trading company. For the record label, see Dutch East India Trading.
So as you can see, it's a text-to-speech engine.
Thing. Yeah, it is.
You've been following along Hack 5 a while. You know I love text-to-speech.
That voice would annoy me.
There's better voices you can install because
here's
one of the brilliant things of this app is check this out. So if I come over here to, that's my playlist. Hang on. If I go over to preferences, we can actually choose which text-to-speech engine. I can choose the Samsung or the Google, or if you install any third party, You can choose those. You can also, you know, increase the, I actually, you know, increase the voice speed all the way. I love that. And then have it autoplay the next pages. There's a few missing features from the old Wiki Lecturer version of this app, which had previously automatically added the See Also links at the bottom of most articles.
Oh, cool.
You can see
so this doesn't include that.
It doesn't include that, but what it does is when you're on an article, for instance, I'm here and it's talking about you know, sawmills. And I don't know, let's find something more exciting than sawmills. The Dutch government. Yeah, so I tap on Dutch government and I say add the queue.
Oh, cool.
You know, and next thing you know, you end up, if I close that, excuse me, you can end up creating just these amazing play queues. And you can hit this download button to save them for offline use. And next thing you know, you've started at Nelson Mandela. Next thing you know, you're at the Dutch East India Company.
That's
and then you're
awesome.
At the Royal Air Force and you're learning about drag coefficients.
Like, oh my gosh. How I feel like this would be so useful for all the different things I want to learn about ham radio, because there's plenty of Wikipedia articles about it, but I don't want to sit there and read them all.
Yeah.
But I could totally listen to them on my commute.
This was brilliant for a recent flight that I had. You know?
So if you don't have anything in your queue and you're starting with one Wikipedia entry, how does it choose the next one?
This version of it does not.
Ah, okay.
So this version, you have to manually add them to the queue. And then once you do, pro tip, immediately download them, because there's nothing more frustrating than being at in Rachel, Nevada, on the tippy top right-hand corner of the box, as it were, Area 51, in the middle of Nevada, without cell service, and suddenly losing your play queue and not being able to continue your offline playing of the hundreds of Wikipedia articles that you've cached for said journey, because it's amazing what you can learn along the way when you seed it with something simple like the extraterrestrial highway, which can bring you to Area 51, the U2, CIA, Gary Powers, SR-71 Blackbird, then the D-1 drone on it. Then next thing you know, you're into Nikita and mutually assured destruction and game theory.
And he
theory.
Just keeps on going and going and going.
So if you see where that's going, if you have done this too, if you have had 500 tabs open, exaggerating a bit.
Yes, I've gone down the Wikipedia rabbit hole. It happens.
It happens. This app will change your life.
That's so cool. So when you download them, I'm assuming they don't take up a lot of space, because it's just, just audio or just text?
It actually just downloads it as text.
Oh, okay.
And then
it uses the the speech engine that you already have to read all that text, and it doesn't have to download anything extra for that.
No, I just use, you know, right now I'm just using the text-to-speech engine that came on the phone. Previously I've used, I think it's called SVox. I really want to see two things here. First of all, your recommendations for, there's plenty of them, text-to-speech engines on Android, because there are so many better voices than the robot voice that I have on here currently.
Yeah. Agreed.
And I think it was like, some British voice or something that was working. I don't know. Because I like how they say lieutenant instead of lieutenant. Anyway.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's really cute.
I know, right? but otherwise, there's. I want to hear your picks on that as I'm sharing mine, and as well as your picks on the Wikipedia rabbit hole, because, I mean, next thing you know, you're at Audre Lorde, and you're like, how did I even get here, and why have I never known? So please leave those. Because I will just be like putting those in my play queue and going on to infinity.
I'm also curious if you guys have any other apps specifically for Android, because we both use Android here, but iOS as well. We can share those on the show too, for learning and for education, because I'm always looking at ways that I can, you know, further my brain sponging because I love to learn, but it's hard to find apps that are specifically made for, you know, that kind of thing, for just learning, you know, learning new things every day.
Yeah, especially some ham ones. There's some really good ones for like ham exams and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. I find that Wikipedia, while not maybe the best source for some of the more controversial things, still a good launching off point.
Good for history, though.
Great for history, great for technical stuff. So if you need to like understand exactly how a UDP datagram is put together, there's no controversy there. It's how that datagram is made, yeah. And there's a fantastic Wikipedia article on it.
But for things like newsworthy that are currently happening in the world, it's not necessarily the best place for that, because I've found, like, if I read a Wikipedia entry about something that's currently, like, growing in the news field, it can change, like, overnight, and then the entire Wikipedia entry could be different. So, but history is great. If there's anything culture-related, mm-hmm. culture is really good on Wikipedia, and yeah, technical stuff.
Like we said, it's really about being inspired. And what I found was when I just let this thing run amok, kind of like a Pandora playlist that gets a mind of its own, that's what I did on Hack Across America, like listening to hundreds of articles
yeah.
and just letting it continue to build this playlist and meander through this stuff, and just each time being completely dumbfounded, inspired, and gobsmacked at some of the crazy things that you just didn't know existed.
Have you ever, like, created a playlist and gotten to an end?
No, there is no, it's like getting to the end of the internet. However, we are at the precipice of the end of this segment, where we will then just say that I could go on and on and on forever about this, but just know that it is just a beautiful app. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing else like it, I know, because I've looked everywhere. And I just really wanted to feature it because it just came back out, like, in the last month. And they've done a beautiful design. You know, they've used the material design philosophy from Google. And I think it looks fantastic. And I want you all to go and check it out and you know, just see, like, how many amazing things you can learn when you just load it up. And hey, next time you're on the bus, this is perfect.
Like
cool. We're going to take a quick break. And when we get back, we'll see. Going to take a quick moment to thank our awesome sponsor, Domain.com, for supporting us all of these years, and remind you guys that when you have that brilliant idea, just like Shannon and I do, we go to Domain.com first, and we register that awesome name, and using the domain discovery system at Domain.com, and their very simple checkout process makes it a breeze to bring that idea to reality and get your website up and online in no time flat. And get this, the guys over at Domain.com, huge fans of Hack 5, and you guys, so we have a special coupon code just for you. It's HAK5, and it saves you 20% at checkout. And if you don't need a domain name in this very moment, you can still tweet them at Domain.com and say, hey, thanks for supporting Hack 5 all of these years. Thank you for believing in us, and we really appreciate it. So when you guys think domain names, think Domain.com.
Previously, I had mentioned how I feel really old because things like hacker classes did not exist when I was in college. But I think that brings up a really good conversation to have about, you know, how old are we really when it
right?
comes to knowledge about hacking and making and stuff like that.
You know, I was thinking about that too, like the bulletin board systems, text files, like, wow, if Kirby is 74 in cat years, how
she
old
really?
Are we in internet years?
Wow.
Yeah, she's 74 this year, and she is gorgeous.
How old are we in internet years?
Let's find out. No, I was thinking about actually how, like, the hacker community is such a welcoming space.
Mm-hmm.
I know this because I was an awkward teenager accepted into the hacking community. I literally found solace in cyberspace. And I know I'm not alone in this in any regard. And one of the reasons was because age didn't matter, you know. And this was emphasized in one of the text files that inspired me. You know, going back to the inspiration theme here, I was inspired in my youth by the Hacker's Manifesto.
Knew it, yep.
Yep. We've definitely paid tribute to this on Hack 5, so check out that episode. And, you know, I feel like while it is a bit dated, it talks about, like, phone phreaking, it talks about dial-up and stuff, the sentiments hold true today. And given the recent events, I just wanted to reiterate my favorite passage and something from it. And it's the one that begins, "This is our world now, the world of the electron and the switch, the beauty of the bod. We make use of a service without paying for what would be dirt cheap if it wasn't run by profiteering gluttons, and you call us criminals. We explore, and you call us criminals. We seek after knowledge, and you call us criminals." And here's the thing. We exist without skin color, without nationality, without religious bias. And you call us criminals, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There's something really beautiful in that statement.
Yeah.
And the manifesto goes on to say, yes, I am a criminal. My crime is that of curiosity. My crime is that of judging people by what they say and think and not what they look like.
Yes. So important.
That resonated with me.
Yeah.
As a child, and it's one of the things that made me feel accepted into this community. You know, when I was a little hacker kid on IRC, the fact that I was a, you know, 12-year-old living in poverty had nothing to do with who I was. And it had nothing to do with my peers either. So there's actually this theme throughout the manifesto about how, you know, it's from the perspective of the school teacher, how all hackers are all alike. You know, they're all underachievers, right? Mm-hmm. It even ends with, the text says, you know, it ends, I'm a hacker, and this is my manifesto. You may stop this individual, but you can't stop us all. After all, we're all alike. And
it's kind of snarky in a way.
It is. I mean, it was written shortly after the mentor's arrest in 1986, I want to say. But this is where I feel like we as a community need to remember that we are all one. And only egos, beliefs, and fears separate us. So this week, instead of saying trust your technolust at the end of this episode, I'd actually like to end by quoting Nikola Tesla. For ages, this idea has been proclaimed by the consummately wise teachings of religion. Probably not alone as the means of ensuring peace and harmony among men, but as a deeply founded truth. The Buddhists expressed it in one way, the Christians in another, but both say the same. We are all one.